Welcome everybody here to the SMM Grand National. I am Toby Wankenobi, joined by God's man. We are finally here, starting off. We're doing the Malaysian Nationals to start with, so it's not the SMM Big Grand National just yet, but the Malaysian Nationals is where we get to kick off, and we're going to do E-Tech going up against Roxor. Man, welcome to Malaysia.
Thank you, Toby. It's fantastic to be here. What an event, and well, we've got Malaysian qualifiers today, like you said, and it's just going to lead into a fantastic 4 days of Warcraft 3 Dota action. It's been a while for both of us having to cast Warcraft 3 Dota, but it's a lot of fun and really happy to be back here.
Yeah, we're kind of hoping our eyes are still going to work for Warcraft 3. We're talking about it before, just sitting here going, well, it's going to be fun because most of us spend our time in Dota 2. But there is just something always special about coming back to Malaysia for SMM. I've been here, I think it's actually now my third or fourth SMM in a row. So yeah, I know I love it every time I get to come back. But Let's enjoy our world of Dota 1 is what we're going to be starting off with. So for everyone out there on the live stream, hi to you guys. Good to see you tuning in. Hopefully you're enjoying our blast from the past. And for the guys who have made their way here into the auditorium, it's great to have you here as well. Hi, guys. What's up? It's a small crowd in comparison. It's a small crowd. It's day one, man. It's day one. We're going to kick off with our bands. Just a reminder, too, for the guys in the live stream, as well as the people here in the audience, the players can hear every single word we say. While they may not understand what we're saying, we still won't be revealing of anything which is out of the ordinary. But we get to kick off into our bands already, and looks like we're taking our sweet-ass time to get through extra time.
Yeah, and something to note is that we are playing the latest patch, so new heroes in the pool. We see Drow Ranger getting banned off. This is a hero which is in the CM pool, has received some recent buffs. We'll see a lot of those new heroes. Skywrath Mage, as well as Goblin Shredder, both those two heroes in the CM pool. So we could see some new heroes. Goblin Shredder recently added to the new Dota.
Yeah.
But here in Dota 1, it's been around for a while. And especially Skywrath Mage, that's a hero that teams have actually been picking and playing, both as a support hero and in that sort of solo mid role.
Well, I am interested to see. Like, it is a bit of a change around. We do go into what was a very, very different meta game for us. I know when I was spending my time watching games at the World Cyber Games in China, that just to see Tauren Chieftain back on the field again, of course. I mean, we were talking about it the other day, that it's more of a Chinese kind of preference kind of thing, and we're in Malaysian Dota, so we play Malaysia style. But I'm looking forward to seeing just how we're gonna like couple up with different things. Like we're in our ban stage right now, and looks like E-Tech is taking again a little bit more time to think about. They'll take out the Darkseer as their second ban.
Yeah, I mean, we're looking at a lot of those sort of strong solo heroes left in the pool. That's something which I think the Southeast Asian teams really like to do, is pick up those strong sort of high-impact solo heroes. Heroes like Queen of Pain, Invoker, which is still in the pool here. The strong side lane hero, the Darkseer, being taken out, and now it's Rox with their last ban from this first stage. You'll have to see what they want to leave in the pool for E-Tech here.
Well, it's kind of open for everything. So we'll just let it slide for whatever they want. And the countdown time, just a reminder out there for all those guys who are tuning in on the live stream, we are doing Warcraft 3 Dota. I know the live stream you're on normally, you'll see a lot of Dota 2, but for now we get to do Dota 1. Is myself, Toby Wankenobi, who streams for Join Dota, and our BTS boy, Gods, bringing you all your live streams. And we'll be here for all 4 days of SMM. Every single day we'll be here bringing you your coverage. And we get to kick off with a familiar hero, a Batrider. Always a fun hero to have.
Yeah, that's really strong initiator. Great to have him. It's so reliable just to ensure that you have a hero that has that ultimate which can go through BKB right from the get-go. Mm-hmm. You don't have to worry about those BKB black holes if your opponents won't pick up an Enigma. You've got your options covered, and it really is a hero which we'll probably get to see quite a bit of when you've got the bans changing. You've got the Sven, and the Drow Ranger being banned out by the Sentinel team. It does leave the pool wide open for heroes like Batrider. We see Shadow Demon, actually a bit of an unusual pick to be coming out this early on, but it does make a very strong support hero. And now we'll have to see what they want to get with the Shadow Demon, though. Maybe we're looking for some kind of strong tanky stunner, something. Centaur Warchief, I believe, still is in the pool in Dota 1. It should still be in the pool here. And that's a hero which we always have to be worried about, and something which has received many complaints over the last few weeks.
But we're actually going to go with different. So we kick off with the Windrunner and Shadow Demon. Normally when you're looking at the opening stages of a game, you want to try and get at least one of your major cores, or at least have enough strength in your lanes. And Windrunner, She gives you a lot of strength in the off lane, but always a dangerous hero to pick up very early on, because you are showing your escape mechanism on that off lane. So you know it's Windrun, it's maneuverability. It's not heroes like Queen of Pain who have got a blink away. We go classic Mirana off lane with her leap, which is just changing your position kind of abilities. So Windrunner, Cable Gain locked in if you're going to get pick up a hero like an Earthshaker, if you're going to like try and do things like Chikiro, and then you can get shut down that off lane. But Windrunner as well as SD being their pickups, I'm wondering too if SD is going to be one of those aggressive style heroes, because we do see SDs as support heroes. They can go aggression, and that's more of a kind of like a setup stun. So you go the disruption into the catcher, and then you're able to do a lot of damage, and you've already got that great position to start with. If you're looking for an aggressive tri lane or something down those lines, then SD is the option you can take. And it can also be done on the other hand very, very differently. Like a hero gets out of position, a little bit too much effort, too much trouble going on that one hero, just disrupt him up, give him a little bit of time, give him a couple of copies to choose from, and then maybe that's enough to get through. And now, as I was looking at, Earthshaker pickup comes out for E-Tech, and if Windrunner gets caught off on that offlane, if it is going to be tri-lane going up against a Windrunner solo offlane, it's going to be difficult for her.
Yeah, I think that you really highlight why the Shadow Demon can be picked up so early. It can be offensive or defensively used. You get a leaner, you get something to give a strong tri-lane. And while E-Tech, they're worried about their tri-lane. They see this Shadow Demon pick and think, we need a strong tri-lane of our own. Not just the Earthshaker, they get the Crystal Maiden as well. There's your duo of support heroes who are going to be probably roaming around the map a lot, comboing with whatever tri-lane farmer or carry hero they want, and that's going to be where they look to get their kills, where they look to sort of secure their farm for that mid to late game stage.
Mm-hmm.
And Tidehunter coming out third for Rocks. Toby zooms on in like, what's that icon again?
Yeah, gotta remember the classic ones, man. Gotta remember the classic ones. I'll never forget Crystal Maiden. Always a lovely hero.
Yep.
And you're right as far as like that roam for E-Tech. Like this, it's gonna be great for them to move around the lanes, easy to control. Also great that if there is a strong lane going up against them, then CM and ES both capable of controlling any hero that's on the field, because you've got good Fissure stuns, that's basically positional control, then you got CM with a stun, and then you got a little bit more positional control coming through that Nova. It has a little bit of nuke damage on the back of it, but it's also that big area of effect slow. So if you're looking to chase down heroes, very effective to do so. And then you've got another area of effect, and that's going to be through the sticky napalm. So you got yourself another slow as well. And heroes like Tidehunter, heroes like Shadow Demon, they're going to be absolute fodder if they get 4 or 5 stacks of that napalm up on them. So I'm interested in seeing just how it's going to work for Rox when you start thinking about how their lanes really go from here. Like, you got Tide, Windrunner, Shadow Demon. If you're running Tidehunter, you're running Shadow Demon. You're not looking at a very aggressive lane unless that hero you're going to couple up with the SD and the Tidehunter is an aggressive style, like if we see the CK, if we see something like that. But now maybe E-Tech thinking ahead of me just there as I look up, and CK has already moved out, Puck's being taken out, DK and Quap also going to add to the ban pool.
Yeah, Rox, with the Tide pickup, they don't have the strongest of lanes. The Shadow Demon Tide, sure, you can disrupt them, gash them up, have some aggression going there, but with heroes like CK banned out, they're very limited with what they can get for that third hero for their tri lane. Not to mention, I think Tidehunter is just sort of an investment for the mid game. They just want to get on that level 6, have Ravage come into play, and then if they can survive the early game laning stage, suddenly they have this much stronger team fight. Heroes like Crystal Maiden, sure, with this longer duration on the ultimate, just can't really have the same impact as a Tidehunter. Earthshaker can't get off the big ultimates until he's got that Blink Dagger up, which doesn't come till much later on. So for Rox, once they survive the laning stage, they're going to be in a good position come mid game time. Windrunner, if you get the fast mech up, can really add to that as well. They can get this really strong team fight, and that's something which E-Tech are going to have to be ready for.
Yeah. So we're now finished our bans out. Naga starting to get be removed, a hero which we're wondering if we're going to see much today or throughout this competition, as we kind of neglect her a little bit over in Europe as well as America. And we go into our last pickup. So looking to see what course we're going to have. Like, we've taken care of the two supports now for E-Tech. We're taking care of what we assume to be mid-solo right now as well for them. They could go down a different line as well as run Earthshaker as basically a babysitter for their off lane. And we're talking down the bottom lane for the Scourge. And yeah, almost did it. And then Crystal Maiden can basically go with a dual lane up on the top, and then it's a lot safer to do that. You know, going up against a Windrunner, and they pick up Morphling, so we can see him come back into the field of play. Even though he was tweaked around a little bit, those changes should have been transferred over to Dota 1 as well, but you can't cast in the animation time, so it's not this quick bam, bam, bam kind of combination you can get out from him, but it's still very effective.
Yeah, it's actually surprising. I mean, he's the one hero I feel like got nerfed in the recent patch, in the 6.76 patch, and got completely disappeared. But E-Tech, they have some faith in the hero. He is still really strong as a carry if you can get the nice farm, get that early stun with heroes like Crystal Maiden and Earthshaker to secure it. You're pretty much guaranteed to at least get up to that fast Lincoln's or BKB, whichever item you want to rush. What Rocks are going to do, they're going to look to sort of up the heat, take it to E-Tech in the early game with a Nightstalker pit. So there's likely going to be their solo mid hero, something which can really just gank Morphling, can bring him down. You can prevent him from getting the stat change off if you get the silence off in time. And even if he gets the stat change off, that was another nerf Morphling received. It costs a lot more mana to use it.
Yeah.
And it makes it a lot harder to stay alive as Morphling. You have to really worry about your HP and mana problems.
Yeah, so Morphling, not as strong as he used to be, and I'm still, though, worried as our last pickup.
There's the hero. That's fun.
I hate this hero.
There's your offlane hero, you're mad.
I hate this hero. With an absolute passion of fuel of a fire, I hate this hero.
In Dota 1, you can't cast spells during Skewer. You never have been able to.
Yep.
So he's not as strong as elsewhere.
Yeah, but in Dota 2, they did fix that.
Yeah.
It came with the latest patch, and it was the reason why I have a hatred for this hero, because he is just so damn hard to counter properly. Like, the reverse polarity, any kind of team fight, you get completely caught out, you get pulled in, you get pulled away as well with the skewer, and you got good damage through your shockwave. You got all of these things just work together that just make Mag such a powerful, powerful team fight controlling hero. And then you're going to add a Batrider Lasso on top of this one. And if Rocks don't get their levels very early on, if they don't control this early laning stage, then they're gonna be in a lot of trouble, because Nightstalker, he's one of those guys that likes to roll with the punches. He needs momentum before he's gonna start bringing people down and become that, like, the guy on the map that everybody fears. Faceless Void as well, another hero that requires a high amount of levels, but also great counter when it comes to controlling team fight. Get that Chrono out there, and a lot of Mag's power goes out the window.
Yeah, for Rocks, they're just looking to have their own team fight control. And what an interesting thing that can actually work in their favor is this Pydunder pick as something to have up against Mag. You talk about Mag, he can get the big ulti off and set up a great team fight, but Tidehunter's passive can get rid of that stun. It can make sure that he can sort of disrupt the team fight by getting off a Ravage, following up his passive, and that's something which can really just buy them that bit of time, allow Void to get off a Chronosphere, and if Void gets some decent early game farm, I mean, Rocks have they can fight fire with fire. They've got the ability to take on E-Tech in a teamfight with this Tide and Void combo.
Mm-hmm. Well, we'll enjoy our time when the players finally show themselves up in the lanes, because we do look to see, like, if you're looking at this just from a pure draft perspective, you do think that we kind of go into this farm versus farm, like, who can farm up faster? Will it be the Morphling? Will it be the Void? And who's really going to bring it when it comes? And you can farm on your safe lanes quite easily. You know that's going to be coming from the Sentinel side. It's like 100% guarantee. With a Titan and Shadow Demon, you don't want to be moving out. That's what the Windrunner on the off lane is meant for. It's what you kind of like look to see, like Nightstalker in towards that middle lane kind of style. And then you just basically roll with that. But you don't always have to go that safe. You can go aggressive tri-lanes. This is just that thing, the decision that a team has to make when they're going to run on their off lane an aggressive tri-lane. If they do so, it's got to capitalize. You've got to have something that like really works with it. You've got to get kills. You've got to look for control the jungle, control the pull. Start with something like that. And looks like the player's just asking for a quick pause.
Yeah, it looks like they just need a bit of time to worry about something. But right now, I mean, for E-Tech, they've got really... To them, it's all about surviving the laning stage. They've got one real strong lane in that what's going to be the Batrider. He's one of those heroes who can just really dominate and control whichever lane he goes to. Even if he's in the off lane, it's about staying alive. If he's in the mid lane, he's just so good at beating down almost any other hero in the game. And it's something which their other lanes are going to struggle. Morphling, not the best laning hero. Mag, a hero who just looks to stay alive and get those levels. So for the most part, it's all about just getting into this game and having those levels as fast as possible.
So, we're going to stick out our mid lane right now, so it'll be our Nightstalker, and looks like we've still got a couple of issues, so Evil just having to pause himself again. So maybe just, wait is the call. We can go with wait. But Batrider up against Nightstalker in the middle lane, really not an easy lane for a Nightstalker. Maybe if you're looking for a very, very quick bottle, and judging by his build, he's... he's similarly going that. He realized he's up against the Batrider, so what do you do? Buy a magic stick, because every single time Napalm goes, you get yourself a fun little charge, and that gives you that little bit of just a bump up in case you do find yourself completely overcommitted. But you've got 4 napalm stacks, 5 napalm stacks on you. You'll be moving so slow, you won't be able to get in close enough to do any kind of damage, or fast enough to get yourself away and back into safe if you want tower rain.
Yeah, it gives you those heals, but it doesn't give you survival. Even with 10 charges on a magic opponent, one hit get you. It's not going to save you if they get too many stacks on you, if Batrider decides to dive under your tower. And for now, we're going to have to see how these opponents are going to land. It's Morphling at the top, having a pretty good time, doesn't get any opponent in his lane. And that comes down to just the CMES just being such a powerful support hero. We don't know where they are, you have to play so, so safe.
Yeah. This is one of those things, like, where is the game going to come? Could it come to the back of the smoke? Could it also just be on that top lane now that he gets it shown himself? And you kind of realize Fissure, Nova, and this is Tech able to run down the river, though, and this is where Windrunner, like, you're not locked in. That Fissure needed to lock her in on above the river, so you couldn't get down there. So everything's fine at the end of the day for the Windrunner.
For Windrunner at top lane, now that this creep wave's been pushed, now we're going to have a much, much better time there. Nightstalker admit he's actually got a good time. It looks like it's already coming out to him, so he's not being too worried about versus this Batrider this time, but it's when Batrider decides to get aggressive, especially with this early boost. Batrider starting off with what it says, I want to get aggressive, I want to go for some kills as fast as possible. The bottle, the Nightstalker, is not going to help him out if Batrider decides to fight.
Yeah. But what does help him out is the fact he can harass Batrider down, just slowly bring his life down. And that's when Nightstalker is able to get his power. But you just have this control, and now we've got you would expect it. You would expect that rune to be picked up in just a couple of moments, because the Fiend Mask is now 0 minute rune. It hasn't been picked up before that point. It's been sitting there the entire time. But just the fact that you can pop off your bottle charges, you harass him back. Batrider, I think, maybe is thinking about his own bottle a little bit later on. Just use the boost. He's able to counter control through it. If you can't follow it up yourself, he's still able to take before the knife or claim it. And maybe that's enough. Or maybe this is just firefighter. Do your damage that way.
Yeah, and I mean, for the time being, both teams just going with their safe lane farmer, quite happy with how that's worked out for them, and not really looking to get aggressive. Even against those suicide soloists, the Windrunner at top lane, the Mag at bottom lane, there hasn't been too much aggression, because those two heroes are just so hard to kill, they're so hard to gank in. It makes it really hard for the two teams to look to play aggressive, get early towers. All they can do is try, get the farm up, and wait for that stage when they have the level to really strike, and maybe it can come soon.
But for now, looks like both teams quite happy to continue with their farm. There was a fun little move that right now in towards the middle lane. It was just your smoke test coming out from the side as well as SP. They were searching for that middle lane, but Batrider, he was hanging really close to that T1 tower, never really giving that opening, and even the pull came out from Windrunner. She put herself in that middle lane for a moment, thinking that maybe she could be your mute. Maybe even the sleep blue have experienced off one of the kills, but not the case. And it just means more space for Morphling. They're going to play for Void the bottom lane. That's one thing you've got to keep your eyes on pretty closely, too. The difference is calm.
Yeah, and as far as farm goes, those two heroes fairly even at the time being, but it's Mag at bottom lane, who's had much better time getting levels and getting some farm in the bottom lane, but he's actually going to get ganked out here. He's going to have to try and skewer himself away. Gunked up. No follow-up damage at the time being. Boyd's going to have to try and get a lucky bash here. Is he going to find it? Doesn't seem to. And, well, I guess they can keep chasing him, but even if they end up killing him, this is a lot of wasted chasing time, and they're just trying to get that time lock, trying to get that bash. Deck Gush coming out. Mag. Well, there's your first play.
You
look for it.
You can see him leaning towards those Wilkins, thinking maybe the neutral be able to deny me, but there was just no way back out of that one. Even with that skewer, once it goes on cooldown, you've still got a lot of control that flies out from those two small heroes. The gush has it slow, the time walk has it slow. They're trying to escape from all of this in one go. It's just too much for a very early level Mag. The first one is built, he gets to go the way of the Sentinel side, and they'll be happy enough with this one, but they're still not going to be happy with this top lane. They have to do something about this Morphling at one point. Killing off a Mag, it's great, but it's not the all end all. And then you've still got this trouble in the mid. With the mid, we haven't seen really who has the control, who has the balance. Is it Batrider, who's already running his Tranquil Boots in the middle lane? Or is it going to be this Nightstalker with double damage up in the lead, looking for an early kill?
Well, Nightstalker so far has had a much better start. He's outlasted the Batrider. Not to mention, for him at mid lane, it's not about getting kills, it's not about winning the lane, it's just about surviving. during until nighttime. Once we hit nighttime, which happens around the 6 minute mark, he can start moving around the map. Look, set up kills on bottom lane.
You're
on
a little bit
Mac,
of trouble right now. There's your catcher with the gush, but then again, are you really in trouble when you're Mac? He's easily able to skew away from almost any engagement. Then in towards that middle lane, last dude's actually out on the Ninestalker, trying to pull him back in again. Napalm Stack's already doing their job, and now Shadow Demon coming in to help out for the fissures there. Helps out and kills off Eatful, and the Firefly allowed to move over the top of that fissure and keep the damage going out into Shadow Demon. And maybe the follow through, just to made him with a Frostbite, holding Zen in position, but they're just not getting close enough to kill off that one extra hero. And then Shadow Demon just returns a little bit of fun, get a quick disruption out. Really, it doesn't affect Batrider too much. Your Tranquil boot up and he has it, Larry.
Yeah, really useful kill there. Night Stalker, it's just nighttime, and that slows him down. It prevents him from getting that level 6, stops his farm a bit, and now suddenly he's gone back in level 5, and Batrider did level 7, so Batrider can have much better now with that kill. The support also, the Shadow Demon as well as the Tidehunter, both keeping in mid lane, didn't get any revenge kills, didn't manage to keep the Night Stalker alive. It's a lot of time and money wasted from those heroes.
You gotta take no account too, you leave that bottom lane, and now Mag is able to have a little bit more free time with the Shockwave. It's some nice damage to the Faceless Void. It also lets him push that creep wave out a little bit more, there's less pressure on the tier 1 tower, and he's also able to get those last hits in, and that means cash to Mag. At the same time, Nightstalker, you can't do this gonna happen when you hit the nighttime cycle. Disruption to start with, Void as well, keep the silence, no way to jump out of there, and it's just a quick, easy kill. Nice rotation.
Yeah, it really is, and as being Dota 1, we will have to have a quick save.
Safety first. Man. Oh, he remembers,
I'm on to you.
Because we know that it started at SMM 2010 when I did something horrendous to E-Home. They were not happy with that at all. They were not happy with that at all. But good time. It's amazing where we've all come in over the course of a couple of years. Go from those days, Monster Games 2007.
Dota has come a long way, a long, long way. But for these two teams, going to come down a lot. Night Trek, Billy, set up one kill in the bottom lane. He's going to really wants to have a good first night time. This is really where he can make the biggest impact. Help make sure that his support and his farmer have time to get. Or he wants those big items up. They want to get the Tide Rabbit to level 6. And Night Trek is going to be the hero to give them.
He's going to make it. Like, he gives him space, but farming up in the middle lane doesn't really do that while your top lane is being pressured off. But ES as well as DM, ES quite happy to try and hold him away. The Batrider comes to join the fight too, so the tier 1 town, Lift will possibly try and slow them down. And looks like they're going to commit. The commitment is there from E-Tech, and they take out the tier 1 tower, not blasted out by anybody, and now disrupts out from Shadow Demon. Nice call for his tier with the Windrunner, and the pitch goes off. A lot of damage to Shadow Demon, not enough to kill him off. And now, Earthshaker, a little bit of trouble for him. Catch is already up, blast through, pulling that Nice Stalker in. He's already died once, he doesn't want to die a secondary time. Morphling, wave 4 maybe there, Flame Break, trying to push that Nice Stalker out back a little bit close towards him. Damage is there, but maybe with a fissure. 17 HP, they do make a pick off one out of Faceless Void. Throws out that Chronosphere, they pick up ES on the side, one last Void out from the Nightstalker, and they do get the kill. And it's going to be waveform down over the top of the Tidehunter too, so Morphling able to survive for all of this, finding kills left, right, and center, just one down a piece, and wow. Nightstalker limping himself away in 100 life points.
That was one manly Nightstalker, he hung around on that, less than 38 HP, just got up another couple of nukes, actually secured the kill on the Earthshaker, and well, they get a couple, they get right there. Morphling picks up one kill for himself. They do get the tier 1 tower for the Scourge, but it's mental. Pick up an extra kill. They find the space to get those kills. The one problem for them is that they had to bring Faceless Void. Faceless Void was farming at the bottom lane. He had to interrupt this farm to TP top and use that Chronosphere, which at the end of the day didn't really do a whole lot as far as setting up kills. It was mostly the nuke from heroes like the Night Stalker.
Yeah, it let him pick up the ES, but that was basically it. And they gave time for Mag to farm up. We know he's got that Sol Ring, also now he's in the middle lane. Maybe looking to pressure a little bit more, Shockwave straight through that creep wave. And this may be just the forcing of tier 1 towers coming out from the Scourge. E-Tech looking just to push Rock back as far as possible. At the same time, while they're in this pressure, while we see Mag rotate off the bottom lane, it means now the Morphling can add more pressure up on the top lane. He's already got some decent levels. Windrunner not looking too shabby at 6.5. But there's a lot of pressure here in middle lane, and maybe Windrunner will have to be pulled if they want to keep like momentum in this middle lane. Because we know what can happen if the initiation from Batrider hits, if Mag's able to find his kind of opening. It needs to be a 5v4 for you to win that engagement if the combos hit.
Are under attack. Yeah, and they're going to get those 5v4s. The way the Scourge team are playing this, they've left Hawkling at top, they've shown a couple heroes at the mid lane, and like you say, they want to press the town, but they also don't want to bring their entire, not the 5-man group up and push, it's 4-1 split, have Hawkling off, getting trying to get that grab as fast as possible, while the other 3 or 4 heroes push and pressure tower. They've even brought in Mag recently to the mid lane, just so they have his ultimate for that security. And it looks like the mid lane, though, is just going to be a bit too hard to breach, though.
Yeah, they were thinking about it, but there was just no support. Voidwind happily farming on that bottom lane. There's no real care in the world. If you got Chrono up, then there's very little chance you can actually fully kill him off. Meanwhile, up on the top lane, Morphling, man, that's pretty low, and that's in fact dead on the top lane. Alice is able to fly as well as avoid damage. From the time the TP right, and nothing, only maybe a couple of, like half a second off cooldown, off start channeling time.
Yeah, he timed the TP, so it was actually all those two disables were on cooldown, but the burst damage was there. I just need a couple more extra ranks. Kill was picked up on a Morphling nonetheless, so big pickup. This is why you get this nice look. You've got the silence to prevent the stat change, and you've got this ability to gank. And if they're going to be splitting up Morphling on his own at top lane, while three or four other heroes are trying to test the void farm or push the rest of the mid lane, Morphling's very vulnerable. They don't need three or four heroes to gank him, it's just two. Windrunner, Nightstalker, they get that kill. Sure, Morphling can go back to farming now, but it's not going to be the best time for him.
Well done, Batrider. Just saying hello in the middle lane, just showing himself to the tier 1 tower, and then they're really not sure about it. Just the Void just moving himself through the trees, just down the bottom lane. He is not sure about absolutely anything on this map. Just this double roaming support combination. Where it's going to come. Heroes like Mag and Void, they won't fear it as much because they know they've got these escape mechanisms, but as you said before, you had a Nightstalker and escape mechanisms that kind of like go out the window a little bit. But they're looking for a moment, and this might be a moment. Batrider able to get a last through, the follow-up stun will be there with a Frostbite, and the Nova slowing down that face. Void going to try and TP out, knowing the stun's on cooldown, but Earthshaker in range for a Fissure. Finishes off the job, and this Haze Spirit keeps on going out from a Fireflying Batrider. Able to find both Shadow Demon as well as the Tidehunter, and curing himself in is the Magnetor, but he's actually got a lot of damage from that Power Shot, then Ravage to follow up from the Tidehunter, looking to finish off the Batrider. The Fissures are there in time, really low on life. Shackle, actually a Chrono, gonna bring down the Batrider a little bit back into play. Urshaka pops his level 6, and there's no room to do anything. There's just Void going for a double kill now, looking to turn around, looking for the Morphling, going back out through the mid. And maybe with Disruption, look for it, but they're not really going to be picking up that Earthshaker. Too far away and then fit one target.
Oh man, great fight there from the Kendall team. Faces Void comes in, and as far as coming in, last time at top lane, he did it at slightly the wrong time. He didn't really contribute much, but there he comes in, gets a double kill. That Chronosphere was essential. Morphling, he rotates towards the mid lane, cleans up a kill on the Tidehunter, but that Tidehunter had already gotten off Ravage, had already caused the damage, and by then it's a one fight for the Sentinel team. They get three kills, only trade away two on their support heroes, and it's Beast Void picking up these kills, getting more and more farm. He's got Tread, Perseverance, trying to build towards that Battle Fury, and once he gets that, he can do a lot more damage in these team fights.
Because we all know how fast Void can farm up, and also how hard he is to control during the team fights. Not just because of his Chrono, but also because of that. Just the ability to backtrack any kind of damage that can come your way. If you get the luck going your way, then you could really have to destroy off anything. But of course, we do have that bit of a change run of Void, and while you see the Perseverance to come up to start with, getting that Master Plan to follow up directly after, high attack speed, if you get that time lock up in the middle of the Chronosphere, you get the bonus damage that comes out, double it up, and all of a sudden you can kill off anybody, and you use the cleave inside it too. So if you catch out 3-4 heroes in a nice controlled area, you can find yourself easily able to bring down an entire team for the space of 5 seconds.
It's going to be really hard there. The Scourge team have to make sure they don't group up too much. Even they just try and wait for the Batrider to get up a Blink Dagger or force up some mobility item to try set up these skills. They need to maybe focus more their efforts on keeping this 4-1 split going, but not looking to push in teamfight. Looking for those things. Looking to use the Batrider, Blink Initiation, looking to use the ES Winter. Those are the ways to find kills and get killed and get out.
Yep. Like that tier 1 tower in the middle lane now, finally going to be 4. They know where Urshaker is sitting just off to the side, so if they want to initiate in, there's going to be difficult time, because at that point you kind of know that fish is going to lock you out, but then fish on cooldown, that's time to make a move. Cat drop towards the side, and then we'll be able to catch up with the Batrider. Gush is up on him right now, trying to move back out a little bit further. Shackle will fly, only a mini stun, maybe enough time to kill him off. 32 HP, 82, able to escape out, then the Echo Slam. Ravish the Portfolio is caught, then inside the Chronosphere. Earthshaker locked in. Batrider, nice flame break, pushing them out, maybe a little bit extra space to play around with. Disruption, Morphling, he's the one waving in, looking for the Tidehunter, gonna claim up with that right click off at the same time, lands through, Void, leaping himself away. Nice time, we get to go off with the ult of Nightstalker, Morphling dumps himself down, becomes the Replica to kill off the Void, then waves back in towards the middle lane, gonna pick up the Windrun, who's only one right click away from the Major. He will go down with a triple kill, going the way of Brother DX. He's looking for the Nightstalker, but not going to happen now. Shadow Demon, he might be his Ultra, if possible to do so. Waveform should be there. Fisher to do it. Right click, one more, and it will be stolen. No, it won't. End the claim. An Ultra kill coming the way of the Morphling. You said Void was getting big, but this time it's Morphling.
Well, Void strikes first, Morphling strikes back. Ultra kill for him, and, well, a big, big turnaround there. Faces Void got off a great Chronosphere, but without the damage to follow it up. You have the Chronosphere, he still hasn't finished off his Battle Fury, so he hasn't got the damage for himself. And as a result, they just didn't get the kills inside the Chronosphere. The Flame Break, the one hero who wasn't caught in the Chronosphere, the Batrider gets up a Flame Break, knocks everyone apart. Faces Void suddenly loses the target that he's trying to focus down in. The fight just goes completely wrong for the central side.
Yep. And that's that problem. Ever since Batrider got that change to a Flame Break back in Ingold Day, where it was you had to actually hit it into a target, then everyone would get pushed back out again. This time around, Flame Break controls all kind of team fights. And obviously, Batrider, the man they wanted, the man they didn't get, and cost them an entire fight, but not just an entire fight. That's a lot of fun coming the way of Morphling, so we expect what I assume is the start of a Lincoln Spear coming out from him. And it's probably definitely a safe assumption. Which is going to be a little bit more defensive Morphling. I'm always a little bit skeptical whenever I see a Lincoln Spear up on a Morphling. We know just how powerful he can be to get that very early Mana Style up. Even with the Ethereal Blade, you know Windrunner, she is actually an intelligence hero, even though she looks very utility. You do have like those quick shotgun kind of options, as well as the Shadow Demon available. Tidehunter, not really. But you do have these quick kick-off kind of like, these heroes to get rid of, and that's where that wonderful power can come.
Yeah, I think that's where Linkage is actually can be quite nice, is that it transitions well into the Ethereal Blade. You go straight to Ethereal Blade, you're very, very squishy and can be focused down after you cast the Ethereal Blade, but with the Linkage, you have that survivability. Nightstalker at top lane, just poking around. He's actually not going to get focused down. The Silence there to stop his hero, but Crystal Maiden TP's up and, well, gets spotted, and this is a lot of heroes committed to this top lane. Yeah, Team Rock really wants this top tier 1 tower.
I was waiting for Crystal Maiden just to be a complete man and obviously not a woman, and just commit as hard as she possibly could then. But seeing the Tide just thought twice about it. And now we do have Rock just go hide themselves up in that top lane because they're not visible anywhere they want to go. And maybe Tide, he does show himself for a moment. There's the last two, catches out the face of the Void. They were looking for that smoke initiation. Now the counter initiation, that Fisher holding the Sentinel out, and then into reverse polarity. Ravish to return right in the middle of the Scourge, and then Void Chrono. It will actually still be Thor to go down the first one, and then just practice off, man. The Sentinel side, they're trying to retreat back out again. One leap away into the TP, Flame Break, and just in time, Morphling to wave himself down. Triple kill going the way of the Cat.
All without the Morphling. Morphling shows up just at the end, and he wasn't even there during that big teamfight. And as far as this, as for the Sentinel team, they actually, the Mag got a huge reverse polarity off, but Tidehunter immediately, his passive came in. He got off the Tide Ravage while the rest of his team was done, bought them some time, but even with that extra time, they still just got annihilated. The Scourge team had too much damage with Earthshaker Fissure, his ultimate combined with that, the Mag, the Shockwave, close flammable, and the Sentinel team don't have the AoE teamfight damage needed.
Yeah, they just find themselves lacking here, and they need to make some kind of homing. It's just in the middle lane, there's three heroes here. Disruption start up with, Nightstalker already put his ultimate for this one. They want to go Anchor Smash, maybe with that cash, and they can do the damage, but then again, Morphling with Replicant, a pain in the absolute butt.
Well, are under attack.
Certain bodily parts, and he's easily able to escape. There's too many escape mechanisms, they couldn't lock him down. And this Nightstalker, I was talking about it during the draft, where he wants to get to this point where he's got so much momentum. We're 19 minutes in, you're running Wand, Urn, and Fred. That's not enough to say, I fear this Night Stalker. There needs to be a vanguard allowing him to dive back past these towers, or something that lets him just control a little bit more. Even if we go like with the Cinderin build with the Yule Scepter, you can look at this great control to come out, but it's just not there. And Void doesn't have it either. We see him up on the top lane. The Broadsword is now up, but he's only now getting the damage item. Two gonna pop now, does actually pop that level 11, so we see the second point up in the Chronosphere. Slowly these items are coming, but it's taken too long. It's taken too long to get these levels, too long to get these items. But that's the risk you run when you run heroes which are so level dependent. Like the Tidehunter, like the Night Stalker, like Phase of Four, who's farm dependent. Windrunner, who's semi farm and as well as levels, they've both gotta work together. It wasn't there for the Sentinel side. And the Scourge, they found their levels, and it doesn't really require much. Like Fissure, level 1, and it's already doing what you want it to do. You can lock everyone in position. Mag was running on the offlane. He was having a great time. Batrider found his timing. And then you also start looking around going, well, what happens with this now? They've already got the kills. They're farming up their items. Is the Sentinel side going to be ready?
Yeah, I mean, without these items up, they just have no sources of damage. I mean, the best teamfight spell they have for doing damage is a Windrunner Power Shot. High Gravity to set things up, it's just nothing for him, man. This does not look good. One step.
Yeah, this is a hard time already. The Sentinel side, they've used so much, there's just a blink in a reverse polarity, and everything is just napalmed up. I will get the Ravage off, ES will get off his Echo Slam as well, and Void, he's walking around on 4 HP, but he gets Shockwave to death. It's just Mag sitting on the outside, just able to control off everything. Disrupted trying to buy some time, Vision not going to help out, Morphling with the waveform in, Earthshaker and Batrider, they are both having a bit of a run on down. Mag says hello, but this is just Sentinel side being pushed back so far.
Mag says hello, he tries to say goodbye by TPing back to his own tower, bit of a misclick coming out from there, but regardless, it's E-Tech just taking over that fight, and well, Morphling comes in 7-1 and just getting really fun, just had this leak some time now, so that means you're going to be seeing the Ethereal Blade, maybe the Manta style coming soon, and yeah, you also have the Empower. This is, Morphlings may be a range 3, but that's a lot of bonus damage you can be getting from that as a Morphling. It means you can be going for a different item build, which is safer, more sturdy, like the Link, but still have some damage coming from that Empower.
Yeah. Beauty of it, man, is the beauty of it, and just so your teammates can draw the control. Mag will give you the damage, but he'll also give you that initiation with a blink to your reverse polarity. And then you've also got the blink and the Ogre Club already up on Batrider. So once you've got that blink in with the BKB, there's nothing that's able to really control this Batrider all. In fact, you look through all of it and yeah, there's nothing. There is really nothing that's going to stop him. Night Stalking can do what he can, but at this point, he's currently using Night Time to farm. And this is something you know if you're a Night Stalker and you're doing this, that you're desperate. Something is wrong on the map if you have to listen to Night Stalker during the night time. Your daytime is meant to be that time when you get protected by your other heroes and they get support. And Hayden is just a complete waste of DPs because Mag just popped his as well.
It's his second one in just a minute's time, but some hotkey issues maybe. But it's for Night Stalker, it's really an issue of what item you get. You want to go BKB to help deal with the Crystal Maiden Frostbite, the Earthshaker Fission Ultimate, but then there's two spells that can go through BKB with the Reverse Battery. There's your Batrider Lasso. That's the other thing that goes through BKB, but it's not really the target you want. Kraken Shell gets rid of it, and Batrider actually forced to retreat here, and it looks like the Scourge team just want to get out. They realize they may have overcommitted a bit.
Yeah, once that Shackle managed to latch up the Batrider to the tree, he knew he couldn't go anywhere. He wasn't going to be able to drag him anywhere too, because that disruption able to just hold off the Tidehunter so he wouldn't be affected. And there's enough support that you can help out your teammates when that happens. But that was a fish from Batrider. That wasn't a big commit. If they wanted to commit, then you would have had a hero like Magnetor just blink himself in. It would have been a skewer back out again after reverse polarity pulling them all in. And that would have caught three heroes completely out. But it was just one of these things where maybe we'll just catch one hero out, get a snipe off, make it 4-5 for a couple of, like, maybe like 30, 40 seconds. And that's more than enough time just to control the rest of the map. Keep the farm going, you play safe. There's no reason right now for this ghost to take any kind of risk. But there's all reasons in the world for the Sentinel side to basically smoke up, get yourself out there. Do we have him on cooldown too? We've got, well, a couple available. But you've got to keep your eyes open. You've got to get out there. They've got to be the ones to initiate, or at least be ready to get it on.
Yeah, with just a couple minutes left in nighttime, and all they're behind is not that favorable to take a team fight, but you've got to feel that Faces Boy just not farming as
goodbye.
Well as
goodbye. Goodbye. Goodbye, Windrunner. Do it out. Meg Charge will keep her alive a little bit longer, but not long enough. You know, the Battle Rider initiated up with the last two, and after that point, it was gone.
Yeah, reveals the fact they do have vision up there, but... That's a Sentinel Ward. They
what is this? This is the game of just hatred on TP trolls. No one wants to let him, like, survive.
Wow.
Three this out done. Or maybe it was meant to be that professional wave into TP. Or coming out towards the top lane. And now will be a very good time to have a TP troll. Crystal Maiden looking to actually get a denial on the tower.